subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. It's been almost a year since the government of India decided to get away with the individual and isolated status of Kashmir and lawfully placed it at par with other regions of the country. New Delhi has since then endeavored to comprehensively consolidate the socio-economic and political foundations of the region and bust the false narratives being peddled across the globe by its neighbor Pakistan. Locals have hailed government policies, saying the region is witnessing a rapid growth despite pandemic COVID-19 outbreak.
Jammu and Kashmir, the youngest union territory of India, has gone through a major paradigm shift. In last 1 year, it has not only witnessed a fundamental shift in its administrative division, but the lifestyle of a common Kashmiri too has turned for better. In a bid to mainstream every single citizen of the valley, New Delhi has given a lease of life to a host of schemes spanning from development to education and employment. A package of around $10.7 billion or 800 billion Indian rupees was announced as early as few weeks into the formation of the new administrative body. People say they are delighted with government undertakings in the last few months, as transparency has been maintained while enhancing the quality of service.
जब से यूटी सरकार बनी है, तब से ग्राउंड लेवल पे जो काम है, ये अच्छे हो रहे हैं। पहले ऐसा होता था कि पॉलिटिकल जो इशू था, जो पॉलिटिकल बड़े-बड़े मतलब नेता थे, वो अफसरों को फोन कर देते, तो काम नहीं होता था। तो अब जब से यूटी सरकार बनी है तो काम अच्छे हो रहे हैं तो हम चाहते हैं कि जितने भी पीएमजी नरेगा के तहत स्कीमें हैं ये आएं तो इस तरह बेरोजगारी दूर होगी और हमारे नौजवान बेरोजगारी दूर करना चाहते हैं और काम करना चाहते हैं
Infrastructure development in the valley has been the key component of New Delhi's mission of development in the region. The locals say that construction of schools and colleges, stadiums, hospitals, roads and bridges has picked momentum. After a COVID-19 lockdown break of around 4 months, the work has resumed and is in full swing now. Authorities believe that the vast tourism potential of the region has still not been explored entirely, and for that, it is planning to come up with several roadmaps. Ecotourism is one part. The federal government has rendered a special attention on the adequate supply of the government schemes aimed at benefiting locals.
इंडिया जो हमें राइट्स देता है हर स्टेट में जो एक राइट्स मिलते हैं सिटीजंस को जो राइट्स मिलते हैं उससे हम महरूम थे क्योंकि यहाँ पे 370 हटने के बाद जो हमारा इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन हमको हुकूक देता है वो यहाँ पे लागू हो गए तो अभी हम उनका फायदा ले सकते हैं जितनी भी सेंट्रल की स्कीमें थी जो अभी तक नहीं जिनसे हम महरूम थे जो हमें नहीं मिल पाती थी क्योंकि 370 जब तक लागू था तब तक सेंट्रल की कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन की जितनी भी राइट्स थे वो हमको नहीं मिल पाते थे स्पेशली वो और स्पेशली जहाँ पे एक माफिया क्रिएट हुआ था 370 होने के बाद एप्रोवेट होने के बाद ईडी के कानून लगे या जो भी कानून लगे तो जो भी डेवलपमेंटल काम है वो रुके नहीं अभी।
The youth of the region which Pakistan has desperately tried to lure into activities of terrorism have found greener pastures in their own backyard with government supporting their ambitions. As many as 10,000 vacancies have been thrown open in various law enforcement agencies in the past couple of months. The result of these initiatives that the number of youths getting misled by Pakistani proxies in the region has come down significantly in the past few months.
We are now joined by Dipankar Sen Gupta, professor at Jammu University, who has been critically observing the situation in the region for past 1.5 decades. Mr. Sen Gupta, how has situation evolved at the ground in Kashmir? And with government pumping in huge sums of money for the welfare of people, do you see a change in the Kashmir's socio-political and economic landscape?
After its conversion into its reorganization, bifurcation and conversion into the two union territories, the government is possibly spending the same amount of money, perhaps more in some areas. What is important is the effectiveness of this particular expenditure that has changed. Initially, Jammu and Kashmir used to be the recipient of massive government largesse, but there was nothing to show on the ground. And the comparison I always make is with respect to neighboring Himachal Pradesh. If money is being spent on infrastructure, you should have roads, you should have power. Now you can see that in many districts, roads are being constructed, they are being blacktopped. The quality of infrastructure on the ground is visibly being improved. Now, has this led to change? I think we need time. Not even 1 year has elapsed since the momentous announcements of August 5th and 6th, 2019. And after that, you had COVID, and to a great extent, the energies and the attention of the administration are diverted or distracted towards tackling this very immediate pandemic. But there is no doubt that if you look at infrastructural activities on the ground, there is a buzz which has not been seen in Jammu and Kashmir for a long period of time. I think we have to give it time. But if this is the direction in which the government moves, within 2-3 years, I think the situation on the ground, both in the valley as well in Jammu, will have changed drastically.
Moving on, the troubles of hundreds of thousands of people in South Asia who were already grappling with the rapid expansion of COVID-19 pandemic have compounded with the disaster that has come in the form of water. While a large number of people have died due to inundation of their habitations, hundreds of thousands others are either stranded or have been displaced completely by the deadly floods.
Hundreds of people are stranded as the monsoon floods in Bangladesh have devastated country's towns and villages. 65 kilometers away from capital Dhaka, villagers in Laujahung have taken to boats and rafts to travel through the flood waters, with some even forced to swim their way out. Sandbag walls built in bid to protect the village have proven inefficient in containing the flow of the floods. With knee-deep water and a prediction of more rain, people have become helpless.
বাড়ি বন্যায় ভেসে গেছে এখন বাড়িতে ফ্যামিলি রাখা সম্ভব না এখন ওই আমার আত্মীয়র বাসা আছে চুরাস্তায় এখানে রাই গেছি সবারে সব কিছু ভেসে গেছে বাড়িতে অনেক ক্ষয়ক্ষতি হয়ে গেছে ওই বাড়ির সামনে রাস্তা ভেঙে গেছে গাবড়
The floods are another headache for Bangladesh as it struggles to control the coronavirus outbreak with lockdowns across the country. There are now more than 237,661 confirmed cases and 3,111 deaths. Meanwhile, 8 people were killed in Pakistan's Karachi after a spell of monsoon rain flooded country's biggest city and commercial capital. Many areas in the city were flooded after the downpour, which started on 26 July and only subsided on 28 morning. Flood water accumulated in low-lying residences and on the roads in commercial districts, hampering traffic and forcing residents to wade through knee-high or waist-high water.
कल बारिश हुई थी उसके निस्बत जो अभी जो बारिश शुरू हुई थी 11 बजे से 3 बजे तक जो बारिश चली है नॉर्थ नाजमाबाद और सराबपुर की तरफ या सरजानी की तरफ और कल की और आज की टोटल तादाद मिला के टोटल हलाकतें 8 हुई हैं जिसमें ज़्यादातर करंट लगने से हलाकतें हुई हैं और कुछ हलाकतें जो है वो नदी में बहने से हुई हैं।
Pakistan is already severely affected by coronavirus, with World Health Organization confirming last week that the country has the swiftest infection rate. Meanwhile, torrential rains continue to hit India, posing challenges to the system, which has put in most of its efforts in containing the spread of the virus. Large part of the country's eastern region has been inundated and more than 100 people have lost their lives. Rescue operations have taken off with both federal and the state governments working in coherence as the authorities say they will further intensify their operations and will rescue nearly all of the stranded people in coming days.
Moving on, the religious minorities, mainly Sikhs and Hindus, have for years been persecuted in Afghanistan. While they have been treated unequally by the Muslim majority societies, the state has constitutionally denied them higher ranks in the government. Taliban, on the other hand, have mercilessly pegged, tortured and killed them. They have also attacked their places of worship, creating an absolutely uninhabitable environment. Minorities thereby are forced to flee and take refuge in other states or seek asylum from friendly countries. Today, we'll show you a delegation of Afghan Sikhs reaching India in the wake of these mounting anti-minority attacks.
An 11-member Afghan Sikh delegation, which complains of religious persecution back in the war-ravaged nation, reached New Delhi last Sunday. This group says that the Taliban and the Islamic State, who refer to Sikhs and Hindus as pagans, have intensified their violence against minorities by several folds. One Sikh, Nidan Singh, who didn't give in to the pressures and demands of extremists, say that they want to annihilate minorities through killings or conversions.
वो मेरे को तो गुरुद्वारे से ले गया वो उधर 20 घंटे बाद पहुंच गए वहाँ पे खून खून साफ रहा शरीर सारा खून था फिर मेरे फिर वो रात सवेरे मेरे को निकाला पेड़ नहीं होता पेड़ के साथ मेरे को बांध लिया इधर भी मारता है इधर भी पीछे से भी मारता है अभी ये नहीं है जगह मेरे बिल्कुल बिल्कुल क्या बोलो तेरे को बिल्कुल पक्की है सब मार 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 पीट से कभी क्या बोल रहा था कभी क्या बोल रहा कभी बोलता मुसलमान बनो मैंने बोला मुसलमान क्यों बनो मेरा अपना धर्म है
On March 25 this year, the gunman attacked by Islamic State on a Sikh temple in Kabul's Shor Bazar Gurdwara claimed 25 lives. And it is not a one-off incident. Minorities, especially the Sikhs and Hindus, have been systematically targeted in the country. Minorities who were 250,000 in number in 1978 have shrunk down to below 1,000 today. Hindus and Sikhs face a lot of discrimination in the public places, with their children in schools, with employment and work opportunities. The Afghan state doesn't permit a minority to even hold the highest office. The Taliban in the past have ordered the Sikhs to wear yellow armbands so they could be easily distinguished from the Muslim majority. India has time and again expressed apprehension over minority treatment in its neighboring nations and has come up with an act to bring back deprived citizens.
उन्होंने हमें दोनों बातों का आश्वासन दिया था कि जितने भी हमारे हिंदू और सिख परिवार वहाँ पे हैं इनको हम तुरंत बाहर लेके आएंगे, लॉन्ग टर्म वीजा भी देंगे, इनको काम करने की इजाजत भी यहाँ पे देंगे और इनको हम नागरिकता भी देंगे।
The Indian Parliament had in December previous year passed a legislation, Citizenship Amendment Act, paving way for the religiously persecuted minorities in its neighboring countries to seek Indian citizenship. Under this act, India will provide citizenship to Buddhists, Christians, Hindus, Jains, Parsis, and Sikhs who have been marginalized and assaulted by the majority. Sikhs from Afghanistan are also being brought back under this law.
Moving on. When it comes to persecution, Pakistan tops the chart in South Asia or maybe across the globe too. It has illegally occupied hundreds of thousands of kilometers of land and has been misgoverning the people living in there. Political parties and common citizens in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan took to streets against the arbitrary decision of Islamabad, deferring local elections. People say that government is apprehensive of losing seats and hence it has blatantly disregarded the democratic exercises of elections.
Political parties and commoners in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan took to streets of Gilgit against the government's decision of deferring scheduled elections at the pretext of coronavirus. They also protested against the cutdown in the subsidy of wheat by the caretaker government. These people say that the ruling dispensation in Islamabad is fearful of losing elections in the region as they have misgoverned and the people are against them.
Election pe taakhir
na manzoor.
Election pe taakhir
na manzoor.
Yahan Gilgit-Baltistan ke andar insani bunyadi huquq ki pamali ho rahi hai kyunki jab kisi assembly ka period pura hota hai ya assembly dissolve hoti hai to uske foran baad कुछ महीनों के अंदर मतलब दोबारा इंतखाबात होते हैं। यहाँ पे जो इंतखाबात लेट कराने का मकसद गिलगित बल्तिस्तान का बच्चा बच्चा जानता है, इसका मैं तो ये कहूँगा कि गिलगित बल्तिस्तान के अंदर मौजूदा जो हुकूमत है, सिलेक्टेड गवर्नमेंट पाकिस्तान तहरीक इंसाफ, मेरे ख्याल में इनके पास इलेक्शन कंटेस्ट करने के लिए कैंडिडेट नहीं मिले थे, जिसकी वजह से इस इलेक्शन को मुलतवी किया गया।
33 मेंबर जीबी असेंबली वाज डिसॉल्वड ऑन कंप्लीशन ऑफ इट्स टर्म ऑन 23 जून एंड अ केयरटेकर गवर्नमेंट टुक चार्ज ऑफ द अफेयर्स ऑफ द रीजन। द नेक्स्ट इलेक्शंस वर शेड्यूल्ड टू टेक प्लेस इन मिड ऑगस्ट। However, the federal government of Pakistan, which in real sense has all executive powers related to the region, has decided to postpone it. Locals say it is a well-planned strategy to take away even the bare minimum being offered to locals in the forms of subsidies and packages.
हमें आने वाले इलेक्शनों से दूर रख के वफाक में जो सिलेक्टेड हुकूमत बैठी है मेरे गिलगित बल्तिस्तान के साथ वो खेल खेल रही है। आज हमसे 2 लाख बोरियां भी काटी जा रही है और इलाकों में जुल्म व ज्यादती भी हो रही है। इंशाल्लाह इस मिशन को हम गिलगित के कोने कोने तक पहुंचाएंगे, जिस तरह हम पहले भी 10 जिलों में गए हैं, अपने आवाम के हुकूक के लिए गए हैं हम, और हम गरीब आवाम को पहाड़ों से हम चौराहों को भी नीचे उतारेंगे और सीपैक को बंद कर देंगे हम।
The locals are suffering as the municipal corporations, which assume more powers by virtue of a dissolved assembly, have been deeply involved in corrupt practices. In a blatant dereliction of duty, even the fundamental needs of water and cleanliness have not been paid any attention by the authorities. Pakistan's Ministry of Kashmir Affairs and Gilgit-Baltistan, which claims to have been doing wonders for the region, has gone entirely missing from the scene.
Moving on to Afghanistan, where a 16-year-old Negin Afshar is looking to ride her own path and encourage other women as a motocross athlete. Afshar hopes to inspire others to pursue the tough sport in a country where the outcome of peace efforts with the Taliban could lead to restrictions on women participating in athletics. Have a look.
Wearing a white padded helmet and black and red motorbike tracksuit, 16-year-old girl from Afghanistan, Negin Afshar, could be any motocross enthusiast in the world. But Afshar is riding in Kabul, where the outcome of peace efforts with the Taliban could lead to the hardline group putting in restrictions on women participating in sports and an end to her passion. Born in the Afghan capital after the collapse of the Taliban era, Afshar joined the Motorcycle Federation of Afghanistan nearly a year ago to do motocross, an emerging new sport in the country. It is also a way to show that Afghan women can be tough too in a country where concerns are growing those hard-earned rights might be lost.
من قبل از اینکه به ورزش موتورسیکل سواری رو بیارم 3 سال تقریبا کاپیتان تیم ملی دوش بودم و 3 مدال از دبی هم آوردیم و 3 فاصله متفاوت که وقتی آمدم موتورسیکل سواری آقایان دیدم بچهای تیم ما دیدم واقعا ما هدفم این شد که بتانم برای خانومای افغانم یک الگو شوم که اونا میتونن این ورزش سخت و که خانم دیش نیست پیش برده بتانن. ما کوشش کردیم که اولین خانومای باشیم که در این راه قدم گذاشتن و انشالله بتانیم دیگرانم تشویق کنیم.
Afshar trains with male riders on a barren lot surrounded by warehouses and private homes. Her parents are fully in support of her passion and her mother is also the head of the Women's Committee in the National Motorcycling Federation of Afghanistan. She said she hopes to inspire women of her generation to take alternate paths and show the world another facade of Afghanistan.
نه انشالله ای اتفاق نمیفته به خاطر که دولت ما همچین اجازه را برای طالبان نمیتن به خاطر از اینکه مهمترین مسئله که باید بین طالبان مطرح شود آزادی و حقوق زنای افغانستان است و اگر ما را بخواین از این حقوق ما سلب بکنن و نگذارن که ما از حقوق خود استفاده کنیم ما احیانا یا که در روبریشان استاد میشیم مقاومت میکنیم تا جایی که میتونیم و انشالله که نه از کشور خود خارج نمیشیم انشالله در کشور خود باقی میمانیم و با کشور خود خدمت
The Taliban ruled in Afghanistan from 1996 to 2001 after seizing power following years of the civil war in the country and imposed many restrictions on women including preventing them from doing any types of sports. Despite the uncertainty, the young motocross athlete was resolute in her pursuit of participating and excelling in sports. She and her mother worry that pursuing her passion may not be so easy in future. With the hardline Islamist Taliban movement bidding for a share of power in a country where it has led a ruthless insurgency since 2001.
Women empowerment is one of the urgent requisites of the Afghan society. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.